Good morning. Today I'm going to talk about the skilling ecosystem, the Skill India mission, and how it has evolved and what is its impact. Higher education institutions like Zitkara University, what is the learning for us, and how these higher education institutions are aligning themselves to meet the larger perspective of skill demand in this country. The skilling and the Skill India and the skilling ecosystem. These are all the words seldom we hear in the recent past, many number of times, every day, in all walks of our life, in all the meetings we participate, in all the conversations. Starting from president of this country till the last municipal counter of the councillor of this country, everybody somewhere or another, they speak about the skill development, skilling, hunar hai to life hai. So all these words we keep hearing. All of a sudden in India, why this has become a talk of the town? And what is happening in this Skill India mission? And what is happening in the skill ecosystem is what we are trying to understand in this given 60 minutes of presentation. And myself, Dhanasekaran, I am the Dean of Zitkara College of Applied Engineering, part of Zitkara University. So before we go on understand what is the Skill India mission and what is its impact and how higher education institutions are aligning themselves to meet the expectation of the skilling initiatives in this India, we need to understand from the traditions, India and perhaps all the Asian countries are known as the skill capital of the world. You know, whether it is India or China or Japan, for that matter, Malaysia and Cambodia, Laos, Vietnam. So these are all the countries traditionally for more than 500,000 years are known as the skill capital, you know, skill countries of this world. So what has happened when India and rest of the Asian countries went into a colonial rule? So the skill got eroded, the skilling ecosystem got eroded, and we got into a qualification-based education system. So that is what has happened in last 150, 200 years. And today, the India is actually trying to rediscover, I am re-emphasizing this word, rediscover the lost legacy and the lost glory, what India used to enjoy for the ages, you know, with all this vision and mission. So that is exactly what is happening in the Skilling India. I just want participants to understand, you know, what are we trying to do and what are we trying to catch up. So it is a lost train in the platform, and we are doing everything possible standing in the platform to look forward for the train that is going to arrive very soon. So that is what is the situation. So with this background, let me begin this presentation, and it's going to be quite intuitive, and a lot of information I try to gather. And at Zitkara University, we are two people, myself, Dhanasekaran, and we have Professor K.D.S. Vedi. So we both are equally working on the skilling ecosystem, and I am responsible for the hard skills, and Professor Vedi is responsible for the soft skills, selling, and human capital. So these are all the responsibilities we share jointly, and it's a pleasure for me to invite all of you for this wonderful session this morning, and I'm sure you will enjoy this session. So moving forward, so let's have an humble beginning. The journey of 1,000 miles begin with a single step, you know, that I think we all know. But how it all started is something, you know, we are really interested to know. So what are all the key drivers? Some of the interesting key drivers which we know already, but it is important for us to understand what are all these key drivers. So year 2000, India saw the tremendous amount of foreign direct investment coming to India, knocking the manufacturing sector to grow. So this is because of opening up of our economy and our close working relationship with the Western countries, particularly with the United States of America. So there is a lot of, the foreign direct investment that came to India. And this pushed this sudden emergence of manufacturing sectors. All of a sudden, you know, we started seeing the services sector and also the manufacturing sector started growing in a multifold. And one another thing that is, you know, pushing is the poor performance of agriculture industry in this country. We proudly call we are the agriculture nation and agriculture is our backbone. But the failing monsoon and the kind of, you know, crop to yield ratio and the kind of, you know, money the farmers get at the out of their harvest. So these things are pushing actually the farmers and the manpower who are in the agriculture industry to look forward to some other jobs. And India being a low-cost labor country and a lack of skilled manpower, deep-rooted poverty, and India has the highest youth population in the world. So these are all the key drivers which pushed government of India to look forward to skilling ecosystem. If we don't skill the youth today, and if you don't engage them, you don't make them busy in the productive activity, and you all know and you can very well imagine what is going to be the activity they will be doing, which will be destruction and it will be disaster. So that is exactly what was there on the door, and government of India, you know, took right steps and, you know, started doing many activities by engaging various stakeholders to make sure we are able to skill our youth, thereby engaging them into productive activities. So moving forward, let me draw your attention back to year 2006. The 2006, for the very first time in India, our ex-honorable Chief Cabinet Minister of Finance, Mr. Chidambaram, for the very first time, he allotted some budget for skill development in his 2006 Union Finance Budget. It was the very, very first time after the independence of India, you know. For the very first time, he, you know, allocated the budget that there is an absolute need of developing a skilling ecosystem. And one classic example I can tell you is, you know, today India has approximately about 16,000 industrial training institutes, what we call ITI, producing roughly about 200,000 plus plumbers. But at the end of the day, the harsh reality is none of them actually know the plumbing. So that is the actual situation. So these plumbers, 200,000 plus plumbers who are coming out of the 16,000 of industrial training institutes are actually studying the book of plumbing practices, writing the exam and passing and getting the certification. So how do we expect them to have the skill in the hand to meet the expectation of the industry? So that was the challenge. So way back in 2006, Mr. Chidambaram actually established what we know as NSDA. It is nothing but National Skill Development Agency. So that is how the journey started. But again, you know, the politics has got its own politics. Then we had Mr. Kodikunnil Suresh, who was the ex-cabinet minister of labor. He said anything to do with skilling and anything to do with the labor, it is my ministry that I will do it. So we had Mr. Chidambaram doing some activity and policy formation under NSDA, and Mr. Suresh actually started working and empowering DG and ET, that is Director General of Education and Training. He authorized the entire skill development authority with DG and ET by bringing all the ITIs and CTIs, what you call Craftsman Training Institute and Industrial Training Institute and ATI Advanced Training Institute under DG and ET, and empowered them to make sure that you need to produce skilled manpower and make sure that all your programs are, you know, really delivering some amount of skill component in their curriculum. So these two were parallelly running, you know, at one part NSDA was doing some policy formation, bringing some corpus, you know, engaging some private organizations, doing some, you know, discussions. On the other hand, Mr. Suresh, with his ministry, he actually started, you know, working with the ITIs and CTIs and ATIs to see how we can churn out these people who are coming out of the institution are having really some skills. So there was high amount of chaos in 2006 and 2007, I beg your pardon. So in 2008, what we known as first policy, our Honorable Ex-Prime Minister, Mr. Manmohan Singh, Dr. Manmohan Singh actually established what we known today as a National Skill Development Agency. It is a first institution that was established, and he merged the NSDA, that was the vision of Mr. Chidambaram, and he also merged the DG and ET, that is the Director General of Education and Training, who was responsible for labor and labor welfare under the single entity of NSDA. And he also allotted for the very first time 150,000 crores as a corpus. For the very first time, such a huge money and humongous budget was allotted to drive the skill development initiative under PPP model. So that was basically public-private partnership model. So that was first initiated in the year 2008. So way back in 2008 when this NSDA was formed. So 2008, India saw the first PPP model coming out called NSDC, that is National Skills Development Corporation. It is the first and the sole and the whole skill development authority with all vested power was established in 2008 with the corpus of 150,000 crores as a budget to start with to handle the skill development and also to establish the policies, procedures and to create the workforce for sustaining the skilling ecosystem in this country. So NSDC at its nascent stage worked with many countries, you know, to benchmark and agencies to form national skill development policy, you know, like what we are discussing, that hot topic of the country today is national education policy. In 2008, it was national skill development policy, and which is attached with the rural skilling mission, right? So these two are the topmost priority for NSDC to see how quickly we can churn out the job offers to make sure that the youths are employed and they are given meaningful, you know, job opportunities by skilling them, you know. But the question comes is, who will be able to lead and head this NSDC, you know? So you also need right people at the right place at the right time so that, you know, your vision, mission can be achieved and they are able to spearhead your vision and they are able to set the milestone and they are able to walk by the talk. So this was very, very critical for Dr. Manmohan Singh, and he appointed the Padma Bhushan S. Ramadurai, who was the chairman and MD of NSDC in way back in 2008. Just to make you understand who is Mr. Ramadurai. Ramadurai was the one of the oldest founding employee of Tata Consultancy Services. And he single-handedly established Tata Consultancy Services of its overseas operations. Today, TCS is known brand and known established service provider in the United States of America, Europe and Australia and the Oceania. It is all the credit goes to Ramadurai. And way back in 2000, he came back and took over as the chairman and the managing director of TCS. And the rest is the history. And we all know what is TCS today. So he was given the opportunity to lead the India's first skill development agency NSDC in the capacity of chairman and managing director. And he was also given an additional responsibility of a special advisor to Prime Minister with the cabinet minister level of position. You know, that is what Mr. Ramadurai, he was handpicked by Dr. Manmohan Singh. And for Ramadurai to lead NSDC and to set up a team, he wanted a wonderful CEO who could, you know, translate the vision and put things into action and, you know, percolate and also make sure that he is able to create a deeper penetration across India. So he chose Mr. Dilip Shenoy. Dilip Shenoy was ex-Secretary General of CII. Why Dilip Shenoy was chosen? Because he was the go-getter and taskmaster for Government of India, because he headed the India-Afghan mission. And he was stationed in Afghanistan in Kabul for 10 plus years to establish a wonderful working relation between India and Afghanistan. And whatever India has done in Afghanistan in terms of the Friendship Dam, the Parliament House, the big university and the water supply system and the biggest irrigation system and the canal system, all credit goes to Dilip Shenoy, because he single-handedly established the policy and governance model of India in Afghanistan. So Ramadurai was very clear in picking up Dilip Shenoy as the CEO of NSDC, and rest is history. You know, what these two gentlemen have done and where are we standing today is something, you know, we are going to see in the next coming slides. So some of the inspirational references which they need to take, because it is very important, because benchmarking is worldwide known as a best practice. So they first took Germany as a country, Germany skilling system, BIB. So this offers the twin education system, the parallel education system, where you have the conventional traditional qualification based system, and you also have a skill based vocational system. How these both systems are woven together and how these systems are interlinked, this is something, you know, very, very interesting. In the couple of coming slides, I'm going to discuss further on this. And TVET, what we know as technical vocational education and training, one of the very famous vertical in the United States of America, and some of the African countries and Southern American countries very popularly follow this vocational education system. And TAF, the Technical Australia Foundation Education. So this is one of the very, very successful skilling ecosystem established by Australia and New Zealand. And the City and Guilds, one of the very, very popular skilling ecosystem established by United Kingdom. So these are all the references the NSDC was, you know, getting into, and they were trying to understand what is the reference that we can take and what kind of a benchmark that we can take, keeping in mind very clearly how this will work in country like India. You know, it's very clear. So before the NSDC go on implementing the policies, drafting the draft policies and all those things, I mean, it is very important for us to understand what was the target audience, you know, they were trying to, you know, reach out to. Who are the target audience? Who needs the skill and who needs it on priority? So that was very, very important for NSDC to understand who need to be catched first and who need to be skilled first. So let us understand what are all the ecosystem we currently have as a target audience. Number one, we have humongous amount of people living around us who are highly skilled artisans, but does not have any qualification. Even they have not even gone to the school, you know, what we call them ustad, you know, you find them in the roadside, you know, they may be plumbers, they may be electricians, they may be, you know, scooter mechanic, they may be four-wheeler mechanic, or they may be a refrigeration or air conditioning mechanic, they may be a TV mechanic, or today they are also a mobile phone repair mechanic. They may not even gone to a school, but they have such a skill in their hand, and we call them ustad or whatever it is. So that is the larger ecosystem that is there in this country. Second, we also have people who are very highly skilled and doing wonderful job and earning bread and butter from their job, but having some amount of school education. Oh, they have either studied 8th class, 10th class, or they have studied or discontinued from class 12, or they have discontinued from class 9. So this is the another set of audience that is there in this country. I think we all can agree. They are just around us, you know. This is the second set of audience. And third set of audience, very, very important audience, the people who have a formal qualification, what we call qualification holder, but having no skills. He may be a school pass out, he may be a metric pass out, he may be a higher secondary pass out, he may be a secondary pass out, or he may be an undergraduate, he may be a postgraduate. He has a qualification, but he absolutely have no skill, you know, very disastrous situation. And interestingly, we have a large population of this category also in India. And third, most importantly, ladies and gentlemen, it is a youth who is awaiting for a job and having no skill, you know. So we have these four stakeholders are the audience who are clearly spread across this country. And it was a challenge for NSDC to set a policy. Who will be my first audience and for whom I will set a policy? So this was a big dilemma. So there was a lot of meetings, a lot of discussions, deliberations, debates have taken place, and they have come to a very, very right understanding who needs the first priority. It was the one who was having the qualification but does not have a skill. So we all can imagine if the person who is having a qualification does not have a skill, he is not able to, you know, compete in the market, he is not able to secure a job, he gets into an utmost frustration. And you can very well imagine what he gets into further. So NSDC was very clear in their policy formation in the very, very nascent stage. They said our first topmost priority to address those stakeholders who have a qualification, who does not have a skill. The second comes the youth, as time and again we keep talking, because India, the population growth is India something, you know, even God cannot control. It is just going beyond anybody's extrapolated calculation, you know. And this COVID, thanks to COVID, what is going to be the blast of population growth is something that we are waiting to see. I mean, jokes apart, that's the harsh reality, you know. And the third priority was the people who are having some amount of qualification and having an excellent skill. How do we bring them into mainstream? And finally, the people who absolutely do not have any qualification at all, and they have not even gone to school even once. But how do we recognize their experience? How do we assess their skill? And how do we reward their credentials? And how do we make sure that we are able to really appreciate and bring them onto the mainstream? So these are all the four stakeholders, and I am very clear in putting in front of you who is the first and who was the last. So this is how the NSDC narrowed down to the target audience at the very first instant. I'm just showing you a very, very typical qualification ladder for an engineering education, engineering qualification based education in this country. So where we have a ladder, the first recognizable qualification in this country is class 10, what we call metric, So from there, you have a qualification based track and you have a vocational based track. So this is the qualification based track. The person finishes class 12, then picks up the graduation, goes for post-graduation and goes for finally the doctorate qualification. The other qualification system where we have the industrial training institution, that is ITI, and he gets into diploma and he further motivates himself to get into graduation, then post-graduation, PhD. So this is the parallel ecosystem that is there in this country. But ladies and gentlemen, we all know that this is the path that is very well established and recognized by industry. And this is the path which is only recognized by industry as a labor workforce. Very, 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 very negligible level of, workforce who have qualified the diploma have further gone for graduation. I am one among them. I am feeling very happy, to have reached to this stage. Very, very less population, given a chance because they get a job here and they get a job here also. So they immediately get into the job and the family and circumstances changes them and doesn't allow them to pursue further education. So this is a typical qualification ladder that is there in this country. And let me show you the first skill framework after taking into consideration of who is the audience. So they have come up with something called the NVEQF. So this was launched in the year 2009. So National Vocational Educational Qualification Framework. So this was the very, very interesting qualification framework which NSDC came up with. And this is how it works. It has got totally 10 levels. And the first two levels are the basic levels, giving the foundation and the skills to the person. Then the level 3, level 4 really gives them some amount of an understanding of, and bringing them to the level of a diploma. And level 5 gives them a level of a PG diploma. And level 6 and level 7, gives the equivalence of undergraduate engineering. And level 8 and level 9 is basically a post-graduation level. And level 10 is supposed to be the doctorate level. But when you actually see from the skilling point of view, for example, if you take one skill and we discuss on this, for example, if you take plumbing, here at this level, he becomes the assistant plumber, he becomes an assistant plumber and here becomes the practicing plumber and here he becomes the plumber and here he becomes the plumber experienced and here he becomes the master plumber. Here he becomes the master plumber. Here he becomes the plumbing system supervisor. Here he becomes the plumbing system supervisor. Here he becomes the plumbing system contractor or what we call a subject matter expert. Here he becomes the domain expert, what we call ustadon ka ustad. That is the level he reaches. So that is why, NSDC focused on these tags rather than connecting them into this. And that is why this NVEQF actually failed. This NVEQF was a disaster. It didn't succeed. I know many people didn't accept and industry didn't accept. And I'll discuss further why this was not accepted in my next slide. But I draw your attention to understand how NSDC thought process was working. Foundation level, skilled artisan, master artisan, fully skilled entrepreneur or a subject matter expert. Then what we call domain expert. So this is how the ecosystem was evolved in the skilling framework. So let us discuss now why NVEQF failed and what was the problem. The skill qualification does not bring any equivalency to academic qualification because, as I told you earlier in the beginning of the presentation, India in the last 200 years completely forgotten the skilling ecosystem, and we are now into an educational ecosystem, educational qualification based ecosystem. So we don't consider anybody who is saying, I'm level 3 qualified, level 4 qualified. We end up asking, are you 10th qualified? Are you diploma? So this is the question we ask. So even today, it is very much prevalent. You know, we don't have that level of an ecosystem maturity in this country, despite so much amount of an effort, that, you know, we end up recognizing these people that they are also at par. You know, that is the first problem. The second problem, the seamless entry and exit of the people in the ecosystem. You know, it is not possible for anybody to continue on education like a school education. You know, the skilling ecosystem has got the different stakeholders, and they come up with the various environment where they need to exit and they need to enter. So the seamless entry and exit points were not defined. So that was leading into even more chaos, right? As I told you earlier, there were hundreds and thousands of people who were having tremendous skill with them. You know, they are around us and they are doing wonderful job. So how do you recognize them? You know, in Europe has got a wonderful process. You know, Germany for that matter, and even for that matter, Australia has got a wonderful process called RPE, what you call recognition of prior experience and recognition of prior learning. I mean, the NVEQ of when the first policy was formed and it was floated for implementation, it was absolutely not catering to these two categories. You know, it was not having any provision for recognition of prior experience, and it was also not having any provision to accept the recognition of prior learning. So that is how the existing two stakeholders who are there in the market, the people who are having tremendous experience but having no qualification, and the people who have a great experience but having less qualification, they were actually sidelined and they were not even considered in the policy. So that became another setback for this policy. And industry, you know, end of the day, when you actually equip these people, and they had to be obviously recruited by the industry. One of the biggest flaw of this process was industry was not taken into confidence. Because today, the HR managers, they only know the formal qualification. If they have to be recruiting somebody, they will only, even today, the people are, when you call a technician, he has to be ITI. When you call the junior engineer or a supervisor, he has to be a diploma holder. When you call a graduate engineer, he has to be a graduate engineer. We have not grown, rather our ecosystem of, you know, human resources have not developed even today to accept there is a parallel education system of skill-based and level-based. So that is the situation. So when these people will get qualified, who has to employ the industry? And they are not willing to accept it. So that was the major setback of the failure of NVEQF and the provision for candidate with skill qualification to enter a formal qualification. The major flaw, if somebody is having a level 4 certification in plumbing and he wants to come to, you know, an institution to an undergraduate BE program in civil engineering, it is absolutely not possible. There is no provision, though it is there in the paper, but it is not practiced. And no education institution in India is willing to accept anybody who is coming with a skill level of 4 and telling that I want to pursue undergraduate education in civil engineering. And there is no provision to accept them. So that was the big lacuna. So you can very well understand, ladies and gentlemen, the kind of, you know, setbacks that was there with the NVEQF, and it was a disaster and it failed miserably. You know, so 2009 was a very, very important year, and they were trying to, you know, practice, and they were trying to bring in so many things, a lot of think tanks and a lot of industry was engaged. Finally, they came down to what is today called NSQF. This was launched in 2010. One of the best skill framework available, and it traces its root from Australia as well as from Germany. It is one of the very well-established system, and it has got a fabulous seamless entry and seamless exit paths. So NSQF is basically a national skills qualification framework, and this is how it works, and it works very seamlessly, right? So you can see, ladies and gentlemen, the provision of RPL, what we call recognition of prior learning, you know, the ustad, whatever I used to say, the ustads getting trained here and they've been recognized here, and they brought into the formal level, you know, they brought into mainstream. So they are able to get into level one, level two, because they are highly qualified. And now you can clearly see the equivalency also. Now basically the ministry and MHRD are the parallel organization, but they are working together and they have a clear understanding, and there is a mandate today. I mean, since 2010, there is a mandate. Though the people who are having these qualifications are not coming into formal education sector, is a time consuming process. It is yet to happen. But however, the policy is very much there. The acceptance is very much there. UGC acceptance is there, and the MHRD acceptance is there. So that is what the NSQF has achieved. But again, as I rightly said, who is dictating the terms in the market? It is the industry, and particularly who in the industry dictating the terms? It is the HR folks. So the HR folks again was not willing to understand the qualifications that is coming from the skilling ecosystem. So that is how then the Ministry of Skill Development and MHRD came up with some very interesting qualifications called DVOC, BVOC, MVOC. That is Diploma in Vocational Qualification, Bachelors of Vocational Qualification, Masters of Vocational Qualification, and leading to a doctorate level. And they have also, you know, interwoven these qualifications to make sure the person who is having a vocational qualification can seamlessly enter into the formal education. At the same time, anybody who is in the formal education can also get into a vocational education ladder and can enhance their skill level and can also, you know, enhance their ability to do more activities. So that is how the NSQF has came into the picture, and it is today a very well matured and very well accepted and extremely well appreciated skill ecosystem in the country. Moving further, who will implement it? You have an agency, what you call National Skill Development Agency. You now have a policy, but who will do it on the ground? And which is the sector that you need to get into? Again, that's the very, very rational and logical question. So, NSDC, with the Act of Parliament, established something called Sector Skill Councils. What we know them as in a short term as SSCs. The Sector Skill Council is an autonomous body. You know, it is an autonomous body. It's like a company, you know, registered under Section 8 of company, or it can be a society. It is basically a PPP model where you have the NSDC as one stakeholder. Then you have a lot of promoting industries as a stakeholder. Then you also have a common, you know, experienced people as the stakeholder. So that is how the Sector Skill Council process was envisioned and the establishment was envisioned. You know, it is an excellent benchmark of Australia and Germany, and it is a wonderful functional model. You know, again, India has got so many sectors. You got retail sector, you got a pharma sector, you got a health sector, you got plumbing, the refrigeration, air conditioning, you got electricals, you got electronics, you got automation, you got automobile, you got sugarcane agriculture industry, you got a tannery industry, a furniture industry, you got IT industry. There are so many things in India. So it is very, very important for us to have the segmentation of these industry sectors, thereby making sure that SSC is formed for each of these sectors to make sure that it is further driven down the line in that particular sector with the processes and policies. You know, that is how it was established. So, identification of the skill development needs, including preparing a catalog type of skills, range and depth of skills to facilitate individuals to choose from them. You know, it is very important. So when you say health sector skill council, in health sector, it is such a wide sector. You have from the nursing staff, the supporting nursing staff, and going to the topmost, you know, the scientist and the doctor. So the ecosystem is so wide. So the Sector Skill Council has to clearly identify the professions, and to make sure that what kind of a skills that is needed for an individual to qualify to meet that profession, you know. So that is how the Sector Skill Council was envisioned, and they started completely working on National Skill Qualification Framework. And there is something called QP and NAS, what we call Qualification Pack, and National Occupancy Standard was established. So these are all the various sector skill councils that is there today. It is approximately 42 sector skills councils, which is effectively registered under NSDC, and it is part of Ministry of Skill Development, right? The first and foremost sector skill council that was established was Automotive Skill Development Council, what we call ASDC. This was formed way back in 2010, that is 2010. It was the first sector skill council. It was established and it was formed by SIAM, that is Society of Indian Automobile Manufacturers, as one stakeholder. Then FADA, that is Federation of Automobile Dealers Association, as a second stakeholder. And third is basically the NSDC. So all these three have come together and formed the first sector skill council of Automotive Skill Development Council. And we all can agree that is the biggest, you know, employment generation sector in this country, you know. So similarly, we have a lot of sector skill councils here, and they are operating very, very effectively, catering to the needs of the skilling ecosystem, right? Moving further, we just spoke about the QP and NAS, and let us understand what is this QP and what is that NAS. Unlike the conventional education system, where you are not specifically developing anybody for a particular position or particular designation. That is why in our conventional or a traditional education system, we have something called a program, which is further divided into course, and every course is further divided into chapters. You know, I mean, that is how the hierarchy goes. You know, when you have a conventional qualification, it is in the form of a duration, and it is then further divided into semesters. Every semester has got number of subjects, and every subject has got a number of courses, and every course has got number of chapters. So that is how the conventional or a traditional education system follows. But when it comes to a skilling ecosystem, it can't have people having, you know, number of years, you know, getting into the semester pattern, then interim examination pattern, then giving them the instructor-led training, I mean, teaching, and, you know, making sure that they go by the subject, they go by the chapter. So, ladies and gentlemen, the point that we need to understand, and the point that I am hovering around, is basically not the teaching. The point is basically training. You know, the training leads to the acquisition of skills. The teaching leads to the acquisition of knowledge. So both are parallel and both are extremely different. So the teaching leads to the acquisition of knowledge, and the training leads to the acquisition of skill. So NSQF, that is National Skill Qualification Framework, was clearly focusing on training to make sure the acquisition of skill is there in the system, right? So for which they need to establish the set of procedures, how it can be done. So number one, it was QP, you know. In my previous slides, I explained the NSQF with one particular vertical of, you know, I was talking about the plumber, you know. So the qualification is basically plumber. And to achieve that qualification, what is the national occupancy standard? So let us understand that. National occupancy standard specify the standard of performance on individual must achieve when carrying out a function in the workplace, together with the knowledge and understanding they need to meet the standard consistently. So this is very, very important. You know, when we define a role, job role, for example, we said about a plumber, you know, the plumber, if we can define the job role, he should be able to do a wonderful plumbing. And he should be able to, you know, fix the leak, and, you know, make sure that he should be able to, you know, do the water conservation, and he should be able to suggest. And third, he should be effectively using the tools and techniques And fourth, most importantly, he should be, you know, minimizing the cost of the material, thereby suggesting, you know, some valuable propositions to make sure that the alternate methods. So these are all the expectations. So ladies and gentlemen, I want you to understand the expectations or the standards are set as national occupancy standards. So every qualification pack has got set of national occupancy standards, and that becomes the defining criteria and also an assessment criteria. You know, if I am able to set a defining criteria as the plumber should be able to read and interpret the plumbing system drawing, you know, if there is a plumbing installation drawing and the plumber I am hiring to do a plumbing is not able to read the drawing, then the thing is closed. You know, he is straight away not meeting the expectation. So the things were very clear. You know, when you establish an ecosystem where you need to assess the skill, there should not be any subjectivity and there should not be any objectivity. There has to be a task and there has to be a demonstrable skill. So that needs to be assessed so that you are able to clearly compare an apple with an apple, and you are also able to bring that consistency. You know, whether it is Mr. X who is a plumber or it is Mr. Y who is a plumber, when you give a plumbing drawing for both of them to read and interpret, and the expectation is both of them have to read the same way and both of them have to interpret same way. So that is the expectation. So to meet that, the national occupancy standard was established. Each NOS, as I mentioned, defines one key job function. You know, for example, our electronics engineers, bachelors of electronics and communication engineers. It is a traditional qualification, and we say that they can work in programming, they can work in communication, they can work in signal processing, they can work in this, because we say proudly, because these are all the subjects they have studied. And there was a formal examination to assess their level of knowledge through the examination process. But today, finally, when you actually try to assess after the qualification is achieved, they may not be able to meet your expectation, because this is a subjective and objective based assessment. This is not a skill or demonstrable, technology based assessment. So that is why the NSQF, when they were defining NOS, it needs to be clearly demonstrated, and every individual who is part of the ecosystem should be able to exactly demonstrate the same level. So there is a consistency, you know. So again, NOS must be a readable document. It typically, we are part of the NOS committee in many of the sectors council. Myself, Professor Arik and Dr. Rajiv, we are all part of many councils, and we are suggesting, and we are also writing a lot of NOS. So because we know exactly what is the skill expected in the job. When I say a plumbing system engineer in our applied engineering, we are giving this qualification. We know exactly what is the level of skill that individual is needed. You know, so it is the other part that, you know, how we have merged that in the conventional qualification that I will touch upon later. But the crux of the matter is the people needs to understand when the skill qualification system has to function in this country, and there has to be levels that needs to be defined, then there has to be a clear assessment process, and that assessment has to be driven by a clear skill values and demonstrable, you know, activity. So that is how this NOS came into picture. I hope it is clear. Then comes the big bang. You know, in the 2014, we had the government changed, and then the skilling ecosystem got changed, and there was a huge importance given. You know, what we call Skill India campaign, and our Honorable Prime Minister, he said very clearly, let's pledge to make India the skill capital of the world. So what is that we lost in last 250 years? You know, before the colonial era, India was known as a skill capital of the world, but we lost that in last 250 years. I said that in my earlier statement also. And the current government, since 2014, doing everything possible, hitting all the doors, you know, pushing everything to make sure how do we get that last treasure, you know, making India as the skill capital of the world. So what are all the things they have done to make sure that, you know, where are we reaching here, and how are we reaching here? the new beginning. The first and foremost, in 2015, Government of India formed a separate cabinet ministry exclusively for skill development and entrepreneurship. This is the big first and foremost activity the NDA government has done. So 2014 it was tabled, and 2015 the ministry was formed, right? And the first and foremost minister, the cabinet minister, was Captain Rajiv Pratap Rudi, and he was the ex cabinet minister for Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship. And there is a very interesting reason why Prime Minister chosen him to lead this ministry. Captain Rajiv Pratap Rudi was the Limca Book of Records holder, and he was the ex-pilot of Indigo Airlines. And he holds the very interesting record of 99.6% of on-time takeoff and 99.2% of on-time landing. You know, so he is the only pilot in India having this record of 99.6% of on-time takeoff and 99.2% of on-time landing. So Prime Minister was very clear, when I am establishing a new cabinet ministry, I need such a person who can lead by example. You know, so that is how Captain Rajiv Pratap Rudi was given an opportunity to lead this wonderful ministry. There were many things he was trying to implement, and there were some setbacks which we will discuss in coming slides. And today it is Dr. Mahendranath Pandey, after 2019 re-election of NDA, Dr. Mahendranath Pandey was chosen as the cabinet minister for Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship. Moving forward, 2015, when Captain Rajiv Pratap Rudi was established as the Minister of Skill Development, he established what we know today very popularly, Skill India. Kaushal Bharat leading to Kushal Bharat. So Skill India campaign was launched by Honorable Prime Minister in 2015. It was established to train approximately 40 crores of Indian youth to make them skilled and employable by 2022. And the target was originally 2018, then it was moved to 2022. Now, a couple of months back, it was moved to 2025, and we never know when it will move further. And there is a lot of activity this organization was doing, a lot of campaigns, a lot of money, a lot of branding, and a lot of awareness was created. But what is there in the ground, the fact that we will discuss in the coming slides, and UK. The government of UK, the Skilling Ecosystem City and Guilds, and Ministry of Skill Development and Labour Welfare of UK, United Kingdom government, started partnering in Skill India Mission and started supporting on the qualification drafting and certification awarding. So let us understand what are all the initiatives the Skill India campaign has brought into this country, and what is its success, and where are we standing today. The various schemes, as I mentioned. So Skill India was the umbrella organization. So under the umbrella organization of Skill India, the first activity that came was Prime Minister Kaushal Vikas Yojana. So this was the first activity that was started in 2016. You know, so when this was started, it was seen as a cash cow. You know, that's the unfortunate problem of this country. You know, when you launch one scheme, then you will subsequently find 100 loopholes in the scheme where the system of deep-rooted corruption in this country do everything possible to make sure the system fails. You know, PMKBY was such a wonderful scheme launched by Skill India, where they established hundreds and thousands of PMKBY centers where the courses were offered were ranging from 6 weeks to 3 months to 6 months. Right, and the people were trained in mass numbers, and the training centers were really given the money by the Sector Skill Council through NSDC. Right, so every candidate, there were two models: either the candidate pays for the course in the PMKBY, or the candidate who is below poverty level, he is unable to pay the fees, then the NSDC pays. You know, NSDC pays to the Sector Skill Council, and Sector Skill Council pays to the PMKBY center to make sure that the candidate below poverty line is accepted and given the training without any cost charging to him, so that he is qualified and he is able to get a job. So the ecosystem was very well established. The market was identified. The recruitment process was identified. Training programs was identified. Assessment process was identified, and jobs was identified. The whole ecosystem was interlinked, and to make sure that only after the student getting the job, the money is paid. So everything was very well established. But you see, India has got so much of administrative and the department level loopholes. Anywhere and everywhere, see, if you have to go and get a BPL certificate, it is a question of 50 rupees or 100 rupees. If you have to get a community certificate, it is just another 100 rupees. If you have to get a fake job letter, it is another 100 rupees or 500 rupees. So, so much amount of bogus activity has happened. This system, despite, having such a wonderful process, wonderful governance, there is so much amount of more than 50% of the money that was spent in PMKVY mission has gone into the wrong hands, has actually gone into making really people wealthy who are offering training rather than the one who got trained to become, earning the bread and butter. So that was what has actually happened. And eventually in 2018, the PMKVY model was stopped. Right? Now coming to Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Kendra. This is another scheme launched by Skill India, where they very clearly defined, if you are trying to establish a skill development center or center of skill development center where you do not have a money, but you have a vision, will, and you have the qualification, you have the expertise, you have an industry partner who are working with you, but you don't have sufficient funds to establish the skill development center, under PMKK, what you call Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Kendra, there is a possibility of NSDC spending approximately 75% of capital expenditure to establish the skill development center is given as a moratorium, as a loan. So there is so much amount of money has been spent on PMKK to establish the skill development centers also. Today, as I am speaking, we have approximately 500 different skill development centers, more than 500, I would say, is established in this country. But God knows what is happening in this Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Kendra centers. Because through Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Kendra centers, the PMKVY was supposed to be running. But now this is not running. So you all can very well imagine what is happening in PMKK. That is the situation now. Third, this is a wonderful program. This was started in 2018, where India and Japan signed the partnership treaty for 20 years. That is when the Mumbai-Ahmedabad bullet train process, that was the first thing. And second thing was establishing the Japanese special economic zone. Anybody who have traveled from Gurgaon to Jaipur, the moment you cross, you touch Neemrana, then you will find the Japanese special economic zone, where you have all the Japanese companies, especially, located in the special economic zone. So technical intern training program was the one step further, where Government of India, Ministry of External Affairs signed with Japanese government, whereby allowing the Indian qualified students, for example, undergraduate BE BTech students and Masters ME MTech students and PhD research scholars can actually get an opportunity to go to Japan and take up the internship opportunity. For graduate engineers, the internship opportunity is for 1 year, and for the masters, the internship opportunity is for another 1 year, and for doctoral research, it is a countless duration. It can be 1 year, it can be 2 years, it can be 3 years. But what was the basic thing that was required? The level 2 JLPT qualification. That is N2, what we call N2. JLPT, that is Japanese language professional test. So that certificate was required for anyone to qualify to get into technical intern training program. And we all know that Japan is the aging community, aging country, where they very badly need youth. And this is a wonderful opportunity, and I'm too sure there is a lot of people who are in the pipeline. There are people who have already gone to Japan, did internship and secured a job and settled in Japan. And interestingly, thanks to our leadership, we have the Nihongo, what I call the Japanese Learning Center in our School of Languages. So people can utilize this opportunity. The next, what we call India International Skill Center. So it is a model where the Prime Minister was, you know, having a vision that I have to set up an international skilling center for every specific skill, where I will train the people meeting the international expectation and export them to the foreign country, and I will make them work there. You know, ladies and gentlemen, I am happy to share that Chitkara College of Applied Engineering, couple of labs are actually qualified for IISc. Though we have not started training the people is the second part, but we have actually gone through the inspection and we have been qualified. But this process actually has not started yet. So these are all the various schemes where Skill India has launched, and I tried my enough to, you know, give you the true picture of where these schemes stand as of today. You know, the difference, which I clearly said, today it is like a railway track, and these two doesn't match, and these two doesn't meet. You know, you have one track where you have a qualification based traditional educational vertical, which is governed by MHRD, UGC, AICT, and when the national education policy gets implemented, God knows when, I mean, again, you will have a lot of challenges coming here. But that again doesn't talk about merging this with skill ecosystem. So the skill ecosystem, what I talked about, the NSQ of that is National Skill Qualification Framework, clearly talks about occupancy-based. You know, this is a qualification-based vertical, and this is the occupancy-based vertical. So this talks about vocational education, where there is a clearly Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship. There's a cabinet ministry. Then you have, under this, you have the National Skill Development Agency. It's an independent authority. Then you have NSDC, that is the public-private partnership model that is running very, very successfully. Right? Let me give you some understanding about what is our journey, Chitkara University, and what we are doing. You know? So these are all the sector skill councils with whom we are, Chitkara University, is working very, very closely. Indian Plumbing Skill Council, Automotive Skills Development Council, Power Sector Skill Council, Capital Goods Skill Council, are the skill councils having collaboration with Chitkara College of Applied Engineering. And many of our programs are directly partnered with them, meeting the qualification pack and NAS standard. So this is where I am trying to bring in the vision of our leadership. You know, we cannot go back and change the HR folks who are there in the industry. So they will never be in a position to accept what is BWOC, MWOC, and DWOC. It is not possible. So what they know only BE, BTEC. They only know BBA, MBA. They only know ME, MTech. So when you have, this is the system, this is the acceptance. So it is a challenge for us to, you know, change the conventional education curriculum to bring in that QP NAS structure, thereby making sure your students are qualifying and meeting the sector skill expectation, also meeting the expectation of the job providers, you know. It is a humongous task. Ladies and gentlemen, I am here to confess and say we have done it very successfully. You know, thanks to our leadership, the kind of vision, the support, and you all know the mammoth investment that has gone into in building the Tesla block is actually a true testimony of our commitment in bridging the gap between the qualification-based vertical with the qualification-based vertical. You know, so that is how we brought it. And Bedisab is part of the Retailer Association Skill. Our MBA, Sales and Retail Program, is directly associated with the Sector Skill Council. And Dr. Harmeet Ma'am and Dr. Preeti, Dr. Kirti, they are all part of the Healthcare Sector Skill Council. There is a lot of programs that is directly benchmarked from here. And our Mass Communication and Journalism, and our Graphic Design and Media, and the Animation are all part of the MESC Sector Skill Council. Then recently, our Professor Colonel Saab KK signed a MOU with the Logistics Sector Skill Council, and I'm happy to say that, you know, we have an undergraduate BBA program exclusively focusing on logistics. I think it is one of the first programs in this part of the country, and Chitkara is proudly offering in collaboration with Logistics Sector Skill Council by mapping their expectations of QP and NOS. Similarly, our Curin and the Department of Electronics has signed MOU with Electronic Sector Skill Council, and many of our programs are actually meeting the expectations of the qualification and the NAS established by the Sector Skill Council. And there are many more in the pipeline, and we are working very, very closely. I mean, this is how Chitkara holistically changed the ecosystem and adapted the demands of skill ecosystem and made sure that we have transformed our conventional education to meet the expectation of the future. It's not only today, right? And our skill journey. One of the important things that Chitkara University, the Skill India does is the India Skills Competition, where it happens every year, and the master of the master, you know, gets an opportunity to represent and demonstrate his skill, and he becomes the India skill champion in that particular skill, and he gets an opportunity to represent India in the World Skills Competition, which happens every alternate year. Chitkara University, since 2015, I am part of World Skills India Council, and I am representing the Chitkara University also and India also as a jury in couple of World Skills Competition, right? So, ladies and gentlemen, I'm happy to share, in 2018, the India Skills Competition, we had Himanshu Vora, who was our student from Chitkara College of Applied Engineering, stood gold medal and in the plumbing and heating skill, and he is part of our civil engineering program, right? And similarly, the another glory and another feather in our cap was in the industrial control and automation skill. We had Rahul and Vinayak Sharma bagging both gold and silver, representing Punjab and Haryana and Chitkara University at the World Skills, at the India Skills level, you know. So we already have established our path, and we already have some glory, some treasure to, you know, feel happy. Now at Kazan, the World Skills Competition last year, it happened in Kazan at Russia. So our candidate Himanshu Vora not only stood gold in India, he was chosen by government of India to represent India at the world stage, you know. So that is how Himanshu, the proud student of Chitkara, he is still studying in Chitkara University, in Chitkara College of Applied Engineering. He stood as the single candidate from India in plumbing and heating skill, represented India at a global level, you know. And what is there for us to feel happy? He stood as the 10th level out of 160 competitors. Ladies and gentlemen, let me re-emphasize, out of 160 competitors, Himanshu Vora stood as a 10th position in the World Skills Competition in plumbing and heating skill at Kazan, you know. So that is the level of achievement we already have, and it is patting on our back, and we should feel happy about it, right? And 2021 journey, I think many of us are already geared up, a lot of activities are going on. So India Skills 2021 is going to be there somewhere in the month of January or February in 2021. The candidates who are scoring the gold medal in India Skills can look forward to participating in the World Skills 2021, that is going to be in September in Shanghai, in China. Right? So the India Skills 2021 is going to be a very, very important competition for many of us, and many of us are already on our toes, and we are running pillar to post to make sure we create our presence and we create a dent in the process. So the skills that Chitkara University is participating, plumbing and heating skill, electrical installation skill, industrial control skill, mechanical CAD skill. So these four skills are coming from Chitkara College of Applied Engineering. Mechatronics skill and CNC turning and CNC milling skill are coming from School of Mechatronics. The graphic design skill and 3D game art skill are coming from Chitkara School of Design. Then mobile robotics skill is coming from Department of Electronics. So these are the skills Chitkara University will be proudly presenting, and we have already shortlisted the competitors. Lot of preparation is going on. So there is going to be very soon the district level and state level competitions. Then there is going to be further regional competition, zonal competition, then semi-final, then going to be a final, which I mentioned to you, India Skills, that is going to be either in January or February. Very soon, Prime Minister will decide that date. So that is the journey. So I have reached my final thing. I am, I think Chitkara University has transformed itself, you know, to make sure that every one of us are exploring our potential, to make sure that what kind of a changes that we can bring in to make sure the kind of changes, the pace with which the changes are happening, we are able to cope up with the changes. At the same time, we don't produce the student who meet today's expectation. They are ready for the future challenges also. So that is where I stand, ladies and gentlemen. I really thank you all for your patience hearing, and I am open for any questions, if at all there is any. Any questions that I can take? I mean, otherwise, it's a wonderful morning. I think I started in the good morning. Now I have to say good afternoon. I wish you all a wonderful and excellent day ahead, and stay safe, stay healthy. Jai Hind. Thank you.